Deposits There with Saray Khumalo is proudly sponsored by Vuma.
Hello, everybody. This is Saray Khumalo speaking. We're back with another exciting episode of Because It's There. Because It's There is a podcast about leadership. It's a podcast that emanates from a question that was asked to George Mallory. Why climb Everest? Because it's there. And I'm asking you, why be a leader? Why be great? Because in spite of all our insecurities, we are all great inside. We are all uniquely extraordinary. And being ordinary is a choice. And today, we have an amazing guest with us to talk to us about the runner's belief. It's none other than Desmond Dunham. Desmond, welcome to Because It's There. And I'm super excited to have you on.
Thank you, Saray. I am super excited to be here. And I mean, I'm in great company and I am inspired by all that you have accomplished. And I just absolutely love what you're doing. I mean, just for our community to inspire others to live their best life.
Absolutely. So the coach days, that's what I'm going to refer to you as. I believe that's what everybody calls you. So coach, thank you once again for joining us. Just to start the conversation, we have a little bit of an icebreaker. So every coach has a go-to stash of motivation for their team. You know, if you are coaching a team that's on a losing streak for some reason and you want to turn that around, what song does Coach Days come up with? You know, how do you change the project of the team?
That's a great question. I think I'm going to go with, I would go with Eminem, One Shot. And I say that where, you know, I don't agree with all his lyrics, but that's one song where it just kind of depicts our opportunities in life. And sometimes you get one shot and sometimes you only need one shot. And so I would try to get, you know, pull that team up from the trenches to get them to look at, you know, their next competition as a new opportunity and to try to capture that moment. And that's where we are in life, where, you know, we have some pitfalls, we fall, we trip up, and we have to brush ourselves off and give ourselves that one more opportunity.
Absolutely. I love it. One shot. We have all one shot. We take it, we miss, we get up, we have another one shot.
Yes,
absolutely love it. Thank you so much, Coach. I want to go back to your values, you know. I've read, obviously, about you, and I picked up that there's a story of you becoming the man of the house at age 11. I'm sure most of the kids are still thinking about candy, you know, I want to go play outside. But man of the house, that's a big responsibility.
Yeah.
How did that come about? And would you say that was one of the first things that taught you how to become the coach that you are today?
Yeah, so I would definitely say that indirectly, it definitely developed me into who I am as a coach today. I think all of our past experience can culminate into formulating our DNA in terms of who we are to the world. And at age 11, you know, I lived in a very volatile house where my dad was a Vietnam veteran. And he dealt with some mental issues and that led to some abuse and also him being an alcoholic. And so at age 11, he left our house where my mother and dad got a divorce. And I lived in an area, Gary, Indiana, which was a predominantly Black city. And it was also the homicide capital of the US during the time. So, needless to say that I didn't find solace at in my community, and I didn't find solace at home either. And here it was that I am now kind of pushed into the forefront at 11 years old to help my mother carry the load along with my sister. And so I do say that, you know, at 11, I learned to overcome challenges, accept responsibilities, and when I fast forward into, you know, looking at back at it, it did help to formulate who I am as a coach, where I teach my athletes to overcome challenges and to be prepared for the unexpected in life. And when that hand is dealt to them, I try to teach them how you play those next cards are going to be super important.
Absolutely. I love that. I like the motivation. I think one of the philosophies that I believe in very strongly, it's not about where you are in that moment. It's how hungry you are for that next shot, as you rightly pointed out. And also the guidance that you have around you, you know, to move forward. Absolutely like that. So in your memoir, which I would love to hear a lot more about, Running Against the Odds, right?
Yes.
First of all, I'd love to know why that name. You know, you mentioned that you, your high school coach became a father figure at a really critical time in your life. What are your thoughts around the presence of fathers, you know, as strong male role models, especially in Black communities?
Yes, I mean, that's a great question. And I mean, it is absolutely so critical to have a father figure, to have a male role model. I mean, I have to say that when I went out for my cross country team in high school, it completely changed the trajectory of my life. My high school track coach became a father figure for me. And so I absolutely had a hardworking mom who worked 24 to 28 hour shifts to provide for my sister and I. And she taught me how to be a good person. But my coach was the one who really showed me how to navigate through life as a young Black male. And I thought that was super important because you can easily get lost and there's just a lot of distractions. And so when I look back to when I first started school, I had a speech impediment. I also dealt with dyslexia. And so school wasn't as fun. I wasn't the cool kid in elementary school being pulled out for therapy. And so it was someone that looked like me that I could relate to that built the confidence in me. And he did it through the sport of running. And that's where, you know, everything just kind of ties back to me as running was this major escape for me. It was this outlet for me. And it taught me how to work hard. You know, it's kind of like your situation of climbing Mount Everest to, you know, I feel like we are all trying to climb that mountain in life, and by no means is it an easy task. And so, I mean, you've lived out some challenges yourself, and overcame some major obstacles and odds. And I think that's what we're all trying to do. And so, it is just super important that in our, you know, Black community, that we're still rebounding from 300 plus years of slavery. And with that being said, we have to have someone that we consider to be a mentor in a positive way. We have to have resources, and we have to have people that look like us, that helps us to feel great about, you know, who we are and who we can become. And I mean, I just can't, you know, I'm sorry to keep talking about this, but I mean, you've opened up so many doors for the things that you have accomplished. And whether you know it or not, you have become, you know, a role model and a mentor to so many. And I've even been inspired by your story. And so we can't get enough of it because, you know, while everyone else is starting here in life, you know, unfortunately, our Black community, I mean, the race started a long time ago. And unfortunately, we're trying to catch up. And so we need more father figures. We need more fathers. We need and we need more mentors in our Black community. And I can go on and on about this, but we are in dire need of it.
Absolutely. I love that. I want to touch more on representation. It's just so important to actually have that representation. I feel that the past generation, I'm sure you're aware of the South African history, they were fighting apartheid, they were fighting colonialism, what is it that we, our great-grandchildren, are going to remember us for? It's a representation. I walked up to that mountain and people looked at me to say I didn't belong. In their minds, I already failed before I even started. So it became about, I needed to actually step on top of the world so that a child that's sitting in a village somewhere knows that they can. So they can come back. I may have tried four times before I summit it. They'll run it faster. But when next time they come up, they'll look at them and give them a benefit of the doubt because I tried just a little bit more. I didn't give up. I kept pushing. And for me, I think, yeah, representation is something that I'm passionate about, something that we as a generation need to actually show up deliberately and make sure that everything that we're doing is not just for us, but acknowledging that we can give to the next generation. So absolutely love that.
Yeah, I totally agree. You know, it reminds me of my kids always saying, you got to represent, you got to represent. and that's exactly, I mean, absolutely correct. You know, I'm getting chills hearing you, just goosebumps just hearing you just talk about that experience.
Absolutely. So, you know, there's the coach Des. You know, when did you first realize that coaching young people especially is your calling in life?
Yeah, so this I talk about this in part two of Running Against the Odds. And while I'm in school, I was trying to figure it out. And I thought I had it figured out where I was going to go to medical school and become a doctor. And so it was, I was working with a dormitory where I was a resident assistant over a floor, and I had to do a community project. And I got a couple of the guys on my floor, and we went and volunteered at a local elementary school next to Howard University. And so we went in, we started tutoring, and I was digging it. I was super excited just to see the little ones, you know, being excited to see us and being able to help and assist. And then I found out that the elementary school lost its funding. It lost its funding for all of its special programs, for all of its foreign language, for all its foreign languages, as well as its music department. Well, you know, Howard is known for, you know, our fine arts and also our even our foreign languages. And so I ended up starting to find out from schoolmates if they were interested in helping out. And I just put out, you know, an APV across the campus and just word of mouth. And lo and behold, a year later, I had recruited over 100 Howard University students to become tutors and mentors at this local elementary school. So we saved their special foreign language and music department, and we provided tutors for English, for math, and we also became mentors where we were doing special trips with our, you know, students and taking them to museums. And so it was one of the most amazing feelings that I had ever experienced. And then I started volunteering as a coach as well. And so here I am 25 years later, still loving what I'm doing. And you know, and I had some hard decisions because I had gotten published with biomedical research. I had gotten into a special medical program. I was 2 weeks away from going. And there was a conversation with my mother where she said, you need to follow your heart. And whatever you do, you better be the best you can be at it. And I was thinking, wow, it was just the best. It was simple, but yet the best advice I could have received. And again, here I am 25 years later, a tutoring tutorial mentorship program that I started, Each One Teach One, became the springboard that catapulted me into being a coach.
Yeah, I love that. I see when you talk about your mother, they just had so much wisdom. Sometimes I sit there and I'm like, can I compare to that? They just seemed to know it all. Sometimes they didn't have as much education as we do. They just knew. And when I listen to you, it's really, if you know your why and you follow what it is that you are meant to do, your purpose, you never work a day in your life, and you just
add
a positive impact. I absolutely love that. So, you know, when you climb Everest, you have these guides. We call them Sherpas, which is really a surname. And these guys, they don't climb for you, but they support you. Your summit is as much their goal as it is yours. They support you. They look at your blind spots and they help you all the way. It's really what a coach is. You know, they're not going to hold that gold medal at the Olympics, but your win is as much, you know, the runners as it is the coaches, right?
Yes.
So I want to talk about those shapers, those coaches in your life that changed your trajectory, that changed the way you look at life, that supported you to be the Coach Des that you are today.
Yeah. I mean, I would have to say that I've had a relay team. and you know, as the African proverb, it takes the village. And so I, you know, as I've already mentioned, my mother working 24 to 28 hour shifts to the point where one time she had fallen asleep at the wheel coming home from work. She was that tired and wrapped her car around the pole. And you know, that just reminded me of the sacrifices that she was willing to make for my sister and I. And then I mentioned how my high school track coach, we called him Chief. He became, that father figure. So everything my mother had instilled in me. And I also have to say that I have a phenomenal family, you know, extended family on my mother and my dad's side. You know, we have family reunions, and on my mother's side, we'll have at least, you know, 100, 150, you know, family members, you know, present at a family reunion. And then my dad's side, I mean, it's orchestrated to be a major event. I mean, there's 200 plus family and friends who attend these events, and it's a lot of pressure when you're hosting it. And so, and then I get to college, and I ended up being under the tutelage of William P. Moultrie, who was my college track and field coach. And so I can just say that, you know, between my family, my high school coach, as well as my, my college coach, and then just the Howard community, extended, it was just such a phenomenal experience being at the illustrious Howard University, and just the all the role models, and you know, iron sharpens iron. You meet some of the sharpest people in the world, and you can't help but to, you know, just to sharpen your sword, coming in contact with so many, you know, bright minds and those who are accomplishing major things in life.
Absolutely. I so agree with that. You know, I think I'm a coach, and I'm always an executive coach, not a sports coach, just to put it out there. I always see that people are a sum of the people that they surround themselves with. And it's okay sometimes to say that, you know, this worked, but I think with my relay, I need to move forward and take on the other hand in order to succeed. And that's not to say the hand that you held before was not right. It was right for that moment. But the moment has moved on, and I need to grow. And I think it's important to be able to do that. So I absolutely love that analogy. Yeah. So,
I was going to say one other thing, Sara, that you always have to audit your circle, you know, because energy cannot be created nor destroyed. And we want to accomplish certain things in life. And so the only way that you can is by having positive people around you. You got to have someone who's pouring into you. And it's okay for you to pour into others, you know, but you have, at the end of the day, you need someone also pouring back into you that's going to give you that positive energy. I mean, again, life is tough, you know, it throws us curveballs, and we got to make sure that we audit those who are in our inner circle, because sometimes the people who are closest to us can be responsible for draining us the most.
Yeah, absolutely. Tell me a bit about your coaches. Do you have any specific coaches that help you. I hear about the shapers that you've talked about. Like when you go into, I'm a coach, I'm coaching this boy, and I'm a little bit stuck. Where do you go for your energy, for that reboost to get back into your groove so that you can support the team?
Yeah, so probably my number one coach is my wife, who I've been married to for 19 years, and we dated for 5 years and started at Howard University. And so I definitely have to say that that's my number one coach. And then I also, one of the things, and this is pretty costly, I always make sure that I attend workshops, seminars, clinics, at least a few times a year. And that involves a lot of traveling, because I always want to rub elbows with the best. And it doesn't even have to be the best running coach. It could be that they've accomplished something that I want to know, what were those key ingredients, what's their recipe for success, and just hearing those stories and learning their path in life, it just becomes such a invigorating experience. And so I'm always in this, I'm on this quest to be the best version of myself. And again, I get a lot from my wife, where she hears a lot. And then I also use my network and resources, attending clinics and things of that nature, that where I can hear some of the best who have accomplished, some big things in life, where that can also just provide me that extra spark that I need and that extra information, so I can help that young boy with whatever those challenges are.
Absolutely, I love that. So let's contextualize Coach Des, right? Cross-country running helped you change the trajectory of your own life in so many ways. In what way do you think sport, any sport, is a life-building event for any young child, whether black or white, beyond its competitive aspect, especially right now in the United States after Floyd and all the noise that's been going around?
That's a great question. And actually, this is going to be my third book that you're speaking of, where it's a parent and teachers and coaches guide to successful experiences with sports. Unfortunately, we have shifted to a world where it's all about the results. It's all about the scoreboard. And there's so much more about the journey. And I know, I'll just use, your accomplishment as an example. And you getting to the top of Mount Everest that was the goal, but the experiences that you had, are the unforgettable moments. That's where the character and the development happened, through those, rough, nights and times where you were, doubting yourself, and not to say that, you had negative experiences, but we all in sports, we can learn so much about ourselves and we can grow from it. And I think we just missed the boat. We're in an era where we're missing the boat. We think it's all about, did you hit a home run? Did you score a touchdown? Did you, did you win? And I'm super competitive, so don't get me wrong. But I just think that the results is a byproduct of the actual journey and process. And when you learn to develop yourself through the journey and process, you're going to get the results as a byproduct. And I think that we're just telling kids from a superficial face value that it doesn't, that sports really doesn't carry value unless you're actually, getting the results on the scoreboard. And I just wholeheartedly, disagree with that concept. And I think that it's all about mastery. It's all about effort, because we want the sports to transcend into becoming a better mom, becoming a better dad, becoming a better husband, becoming a better wife, becoming, you know, a better community leader, learning how to be a great teammate, learning how to sacrifice for others, to be a part of a mission, to be a part of a community, to make this world a much better place. And we can learn those things in sports, but again, we're kind of missing that boat a bit. And that's kind of the impetus of starting Kids Elite Sports. And I know we'll talk a little bit about that, you know, later.
Absolutely. I like what you're saying, because it's really, it's not about the summit, you know, it's about the journey to the summit. Because if you think about it, Everest, that's between 6 to 8 weeks journey. But you stand on the summit for a fleeting moment. If that's what it was all about, then we all, you know, we missed the boat. I think growth happens during the journey to the summit. So absolutely subscribe to that. So let's go back to some of the amazing things that you've achieved. You know, Eleanor Roosevelt High School in Greenbelt, I believe, holds a special place in your heart from what I've read. You made history by leading a team to 20 national titles and 10 state titles. I hope I didn't miss anything. Congratulations.
No, thank you.
At the Penn Relays, you brought home 2 championships for American title in 2007. And in 2008, you helped Roosevelt to win another Penn Relay title. I mean, this is crazy. This is just epic. Right? What kind of mental work did you have to instill in the team for them to win all these titles confidently under your guidance?
Yeah, so, I mean, first, you know, Penn Relays is, it's the Super Bowl of high school track and field. I mean, we had over 40,000 spectators, thousands, tens of thousands of other spectators streaming in. And it was this David versus Goliath, where the Jamaican teams have been so dominant that, I mean, it was really tough for any American team to overcome. And the question, I mean, it really, I mean, hits the nail on the head in terms of that once all the preparation is done, you absolutely have to believe that you can do it. And I think that there have been other USA teams that had gone against the Jamaicans that were actually just as good, but didn't believe that they were. And they really had a challenging time when they went against the Jamaicans. And so I spent a lot of time on the mental development of our team, just making sure that they were developing that grit, that determination. And it took workshops, it took workouts, it took times where I'm pouring in to their confidence, to their self-esteem. I'm bringing in other speakers, you know, such as yourself and you know, of like-minded people who have done successful things that are now pouring into them, having them to believe. And, you know, in life, you have to be willing to give up who you are for who you want to become. And, you know, and there's a lot of in-between and sacrifices that have to be made. And so we were getting it done. We were doing what we needed to do physically. And there was this, you know, spiritual journey where we really had to dig down deep to believe that we could be successful. And you know, it was a lot of speeches, a lot of individual talk. I would actually talk about, and I think this is where Running Against the Odds was born, because it was a time when I'm speaking to the team about some of my challenges as a child and how I would triumph later. They were inspired, and that's where, you know, even one of the young ladies said, "Hey, you need to write a book. People need to hear these stories." And so I've thanked her 1,000 times for just kind of putting that, you know, that nugget, you know, into, you know, my Rolodex. So it was where, you know, sharing these life lessons and my own experiences overcoming obstacles and odds, to get them to really know that, hey, where you are now doesn't have to be where you are going to be, you know, in the next year or next 2 years. And it was a great journey. And I'm just super thankful that I was, you know, honored to coach these young ladies.
Absolutely. I think it's always important to listen, because you never know where your inspiration would come from. And I thank her as well for pushing me to that. I can't wait to read your book, by the way, as well. So let's go back to something that's a little, I think it's a public secret. You know, it is often said that America, quite frankly, in the world at large, love what Black people can produce through their labor or their art, but doesn't really like, you know, who they are as a people trying to live their own lives, be it as artists or sports stars, they say. In what way does your book, Running Against All Odds, touch on key issues around systemic racism, not just in the US, maybe around the world, because I don't believe that this is a US problem. This is a global tragic crisis.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that, you know, we live in this capitalistic society where it's, you know, survival of the fittest. And if I can have someone to make my life easier and more comfortable, so be it, you know, and it is just inhumane in so many ways that we have people that use other people for their own selfish benefits. And so Running Against the Odds, I tell the story about Gary, Indiana. As I mentioned, it was the homicide capital of the US. Well, that wasn't the case in the 1950s and 60s when the steel mill industry was booming in Gary. It was a steel town. And just like you said, I mean, it was okay when we had the great migration of all of these, you know, Black workers to move into Gary to serve, you know, our white community, our world. And it was okay for that initially. And then when we started to lose bidding wars to other countries to produce steel and to export it, then the steel industry started to decline. And once the steel industry started to decline, then it became, all right, well, we're done with you. And instead of there being some things that were done to save our city, it was some intentional things where we're going to just dry it up and we're not going to give it any stimulus money. We're not going to pour any more resources into it. And so, you know, our state, our country just kind of watched from the sideline where unemployment went up, crime went up, homicides went up, schools went down. We all know that when education goes down, that increases the chances of a lot, but it increases the chances of you dropping out. It increases the chances of you not only not finishing school, but you have a higher chance of ending up in a prison system. It just goes on and on. I also highlight the journey to South Africa, where I give, you know, a little bit of light to apartheid and some of the things that that we went through as a people, where that was another form of slavery. And I just try to use my platform just to even to this current day that, you know, I have 2 degrees, I have other certificates and national level a national level platform, but and I have a book, of course, and I'm a business owner, I say all of those things where if I go running at nighttime with my athletic gear on, I'm being looked at a different way than if I have a suit or tie on, or if, you know, I'm in, you know, casual clothes. And so, I've been profiled so many times in my life. I'm still profiled to this day. And if I go running at night, it's dangerous for me. And, you know, no one cares all the success and all the things that I have been willing to do for those in my community and throughout the world, that I'm still going to be looked at a certain way. And so this systemic racism is still prevalent to this day. And, you know, we're out here to fight the good fight so that we can all have peace, love, and happiness. And at the end of the day, that's all we want. We want peace, love, and happiness. And we want it for our kids, and we want it for, you know, our generations. We just want to feel like we had a legitimate chance to do our part and experience a great life.
Yeah, absolutely. It's actually interesting. As you were speaking, I'm thinking about, I've got relatives that are in the U.S. What they worry about in terms of their young kids, 18, 19 year old, when they get out of the house, it's completely different to what my Caucasian friends would worry about in terms of their kids. Don't get into drugs. Yeah. It's like, when you see the police, it's instructions are completely different, you know, because what is expected or is experienced by one is not necessarily what's experienced by the other. Anyway, so more often than not, every young child wants to be, say, Serena Williams, Naomi Osaka, maybe Tiger Woods, even Michael Jordan, you know, when they grow up, because that's what they see as themselves. Yeah. Where, you know, Rihanna, just to name a few. How do you think we should encourage discipline in children who want to get into sport, but without sacrificing their childhood?
Yeah, I mean, I always say this, that sports is not who you are, it's something you do. And also, you know, there's this big assumption that all successful sports, you know, heroes are happy. And that's not necessarily the case. Unfortunately, you see a lot of very talented sports heroes who are actually struggling with a lot of demons in life. And they paid at a huge cost. And as a high level coach, I always say, you have to ask yourself, what am I asking my kid to do? And what will it cost my kid? Is it going to cost my kid some mental anguish? Is it going to cause my kid to be more selfish? Is it going to cause my kid? And so those are super important questions. And also in the Black community, you know, I have a hard time talking to one of our kids about becoming the next Michael Jordan. I want to know if you're going to be the next, you know, best chemist in the world. Are you going to be the next best engineer, the next best teacher? And so even my daughter, at one point, she says, I want to be a professional soccer player. But now if she ever brings that up, I give her a look and she says, I want to be a journalist. And I want to. And so she knows that I'm okay with you wanting to be the best soccer player. I will support that. But that's not the end goal here. The end goal is to pour into, how can you do things, take things from sports to become, because if you have a successful career, you're planning until 25, 30, you know, now what are you gonna do the next 40, 50 years of your life? And so I just think it's so critical that, and I know I just kind of hit a tangent there, but I, you know, this is just to those parents who are pushing their kids to be that next, you know, superstar. And now that we have the Venus and Serena movie out, I'm a little afraid that you're going to see some parents pouring into their kids even more. And I just think we have to be careful and ask ourselves, what is the end goal? What is the bigger picture? You know, a lot of times you can make more money being a business owner and an investor and then you can in a overall from a sports career, and there's this other stat that I just want to bring light to, that 70 to 80% of our, minority professional basketball and football players go bankrupt 5 years after they stop playing their professional sport. I mean, so it's kind of going back to the question before, we're okay as long as, we're providing labor. We're okay as long as we're providing that entertainment. But if we don't wake up and understand the bigger picture, the bigger cause, and I'll go back to my daughter again, and I would even say, if you are so fortunate that you become a professional soccer player, I hope she doesn't watch this, but she's not even close to it. But if she does, whatever you do, then use your platform for some good. It's not about you. It's not about, me. It's about we. It's about our community and how you're changing the lives of others. And we just kind of lose track with sports. And I think we just get so heavily involved and super competitive. And as parents, as coaches, our kids' journey become our journey. And don't get me wrong, I'm super supportive of that, but we got to make sure that we're thinking about the bigger picture.
Absolutely, I love that. I think one of the conversations that we are now having is about intergenerational wealth. Mm-hmm. It's not about the now, it's about what is it that we're going to leave for the next generation, which becomes quite important. And I think that's where we miss the mark many times in our communities. Okay. Something else that I want to pick up on that you mentioned is a philosophy of Ubuntu. I don't know if you've come across that term. It's an African term that says, I am because we are, or I am because you are. It's about knowing that I am nothing if you are nothing, by supporting you, by investing in you. And it's really where this a child is raised by the community comes from. And I think we sometimes, because of capitalism and being made to look all romantic and glamorous, we all forget about where we come from. We forget about Ubuntu as something that is uniquely African, something that will take us, will differentiate us from the rest, and will ensure that I don't grow and prosper on my own. I prosper with the continent, and we make sure, which something else that I'm very passionate about, that the next generation are not second-class citizens in the global village, because you and I made a difference. I'm going off track, but
I love it.
You talked about coming to South Africa. Tell us a little bit more about that. What did that mean to you? What did you expect before coming? What shifted when you came? And how did that impact your life?
Well, I being at Howard University, I will say that, it enlightened me a lot. Unfortunately, in my first 18 years, even being from a predominantly Black city, we didn't have the cultural curriculum. And that's also part of the systemic racism as well, that here it is that we're not learning about one of the most horrific acts of inhumanity that's a part of history, which is the Middle Passages, to understand how we were disconnected from our culture, our roots of who we are. And I think that's where a lot of people have to understand that if you don't know who you are or where you've been, you'll never know where you're going. And that's where this modern day, slavery also happens, where this systemic racism continue to perpetuate, because we do not connect to our strengths as a people. We do not connect to our strengths as a people, which is super important. And when you're not connected, then you're just kind of that ship in the middle of the ocean, or that boat in the middle of the ocean without your oars, and or a rudder that's going to give you direction. And we're lost because we didn't realize the strengths of us being kings and queens and inventors and the riches that we had stripped from us. And so, you know, with that being said, it was, I learned a lot at Howard about who I was, but it wasn't until I stepped foot into the Soweto townships a year after apartheid, where I really realized the devastation that was being created. And so it was a lot of mixed emotions. And I just, you know, here it is that I stepped foot on the, you know, the continent, the motherland, and it was, to me, just such a spiritual connection. And I mean, I just felt at home. And regardless of the devastation that I'm experiencing when I step foot into the Soweto townships, the community was unbelievable. The spirit of our people was unbelievable. Regardless of everything that I'm seeing and witnessing, you know, the homes being, you know, just, I mean, the homes that I was experiencing there, I mean, when you talk about, you know, some of the things that we experienced in the US, you know, the US, it was not even comparable. And so, and I'll never forget going to this, you know, block party celebration where there's thousands of members of the community, and the spirit was just unbelievable. I was able to spend Christmas there and understanding that it's not about the materialistic things, but it's about the things that it's about people. It's about our people. It's about, you know, connecting to people and being there to support and love one another. And I mean, it just was an amazing experience that no doubt about it, it ended up being a spiritual, you know, upliftment. And it also just showed me the bigger picture of the world. And also what I also need to do in terms of my part of making this world a better place for everyone.
Absolutely. I love that. And I love that you were able to pick that up in Soweto and in the middle of devastation that was a result of apartheid, especially a year after 1994, I'm sure. Yeah. So in addition to writing a book, but you talked about it being the third book, you know, so in addition to being an author, I think I should call you that, you have founded Kids Elite Sports, a youth sports development organization that operates summer camps, I believe, and specializes in training for committed youth athletes, right? How has the foundation fared, especially in the middle of the pandemic? How have you managed to survive, if at all?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And let me bring a little bit of light to me saying the third book. So Running Against the Odds is the first book. I am currently working on a children's version, and then the third book will be the parent and coach's guide to successfully coaching your student athlete. And so I want to say that Kids Elite Sports, it is a camp that started with 10 campers, and now we, you know, 8 years later, we have over 1,000 campers, 4 different sites. And these are kids from the ages of 4 through 12. Now, I would say right before the pandemic was where as a business, we were starting to, you know, to be strongly in the black, and we were, we were right where we wanted to be from a business standpoint. And when the pandemic hit, unfortunately, it sent us back 3-4 years where we really struggled. We really struggled from a financial standpoint, because I still paid my staff. I had the overhead of a business, and it was super uncomfortable. And a lot of conversations with, do I want to continue to do this? And you know, when the sun comes up in the morning, I realize that I got a lot of campers that's depending on us to be there. And I have a lot of staff members that absolutely loves what we do for our community. And so here I am. We were hoping to have a really great summer, and we're still in the trenches, but things are looking definitely a lot more positive.
Absolutely.
So if there's any investors out there, we'll take them.
I love that. I think if there are investors that heard this, that are out there, that believe in investing in the next generation, Coach Des is the man to actually support. Coach Des, I want to go back to your book. If somebody picks up your book, what are the 3 key lessons that you want them to walk away with?
Oh, that's a great question. I think that one is that you're not alone, that we all go through trials and tribulations, and you're not alone in life. Take advantage of your resources, your mentors, the positive people. You know, audit your circle. Make sure you put yourself around positive people. I think number 2 is that, you know, adversity doesn't have to define who you are. It can reveal who you are. And through adversity, you got to allow yourself to grow. You have to allow yourself to utilize challenges in life that is going to propel you and catapult you to being the best version of yourself. You know, I tell a story in Running Against the Odds where I'm going after, you know, one of my goals in high school cross country, and I fall flat on my face as I'm going after this goal. And then I had to wake up the next day, and I allow that shortcoming to motivate me to work even harder. And I think the 3rd thing is, giving up who you are for who you want to become, that you got to be willing to make those sacrifices. And you know, a goal without a plan is only a wish. And we have to be willing to put that plan together. And when you put that plan together, you got to be prepared to give some things up that are keeping you stuck, that are keeping you ordinary, that's keeping you to be average. And you got to be willing to stretch yourself and cross that threshold. And it's going to be uncomfortable at times, and you're going to doubt yourself at times, but you got to keep believing, and you got to keep, you know, moving up one stair at a time. And then eventually you're going to be at the top of that staircase.
Absolutely. I always say that success is just a step out of your comfort zone.
Yes, 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 yes.
Anyway, Coach, it's been epic. It's been amazing. But my last question to you is, describe your best challenge and how it propelled you forward.
Yeah.
What's the best failure? I don't like the word. What is the best challenge that you've encountered in your journey? And how did you use it to prepare you forward?
Yeah. So I think I was just kind of touching on it a bit as I was sharing, you know, the 3 lessons, and there's so many more lessons than Running Against the Odds. But, you know, it was this high school cross country race where I really felt like I prepared, you know, running 60, 70 miles a week. And I wanted to be in the top 10, and in a big race where you get to sit in these big lavish chairs and get these big medallions. And I had dreamt about being one of these top 10 finishers. Well, the race started, and I was right where I needed to be the first mile. By mile number two, I realized, well, this is not going according to plan, because I was in about 35th, 40th place. And then I kept sandbagging, and I eventually finished up 75th place. And I got this little measly ribbon. And I'll never forget that. I felt so dejected. And it was a very lonely moment. And after a conversation with my coach, it really didn't help a whole lot, but it did have me to reflect. So the next morning, I ended up taking this ribbon and I put it next to my light switch. And every morning that I flick that light switch on, I'm looking at that ribbon, and it gave me this sick feeling, but it gave me the feeling that I don't want to have this feeling again. And it made me work harder. It made me sacrifice more. It just allowed me to recalibrate, all right, who I am and who I want to be. And that ribbon is responsible for me garnering a track and field and cross country scholarship the following year. It was the work that I put in after I received that ribbon. And so that's what life is all about. We gotta use our tough moments. We gotta get something out of those tough moments, or those tough moments, they begin to define who we are, and in a negative way. And if you go through it, go ahead and get a reward from it. So now I'm rewarded from that ribbon. And I know where that ribbon is to this day. I have no idea where some of my medals and trophies are. And so it's those moments that's going to define us the most.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that. Thank you so much for spending so much time with us. If anyone wants to get, their hands on your book, where do they go? Is there a website, anything that you can share?
Yes. So yes, Amazon.com. It's the number one new release on Amazon. I'm also an Under Armour coaching ambassador. And so it is definitely a very successful journey with the book. And I also want to say that you can reach me on Instagram at Coach Des Dunham. That's Coach D-E-Z-D-U-N-H-A-M. Also, I have a website, www.coachdesdunham.com. And so please reach out, and I would love to hear from some of the listeners here.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Absolutely. Thank you so much once again, Coach Des, for your time and for reminding us that we are all uniquely extraordinary. We must just dig deep, step a little bit out of our comfort zone, and success is definitely ours to have. And I hope to chat to you again soon. There's a lot that you're doing that I can relate to. I believe that I can add a little bit of value, and I'm hoping to chat to you again soon. Thank you.
Yeah, I would love to have you come talk during our Girls Leadership Program. So I would love to talk to you more about that. And it would be just awesome for our girls to hear from you.
Absolutely. God bless.
All right. God bless.
Because It's There with Saray Khumalo is proudly sponsored by Vuma.